Hi there. There's some news about North and South Korea and China and the US, and that's of course because WikiLeaks published a number of messages sent by diplomats. I don't agree with the fact that they are published. I think that it's very dangerous to do that because diplomacy is about presenting the truth and finding out the truth in a very trustful environment. And very carefully dosing whatever you want to reveal or tell somebody else. So you have to speak honestly and cordially, and if those types of communication come out, it's very easy to misinterpret it. That's why you have diplomats, to be the communicative connection between people with very strong opinions. But from these leaked documents, it appears that Saudi Arabia and the countries in the Middle East have been asking for someone dealing with Iran and preventing it from nuclear weapons for quite some time. So that's then it becomes a little bit better to understand that the US is actually pushing for war with Iran from the Republican side, because those are of course representing the industrialists, which represent the oil supply. So they think it's a good deal. But Saudi Arabia also has done that towards China, and it appears that China could have been helping Saudi Arabia, and then it would have had a good deal for oil. I don't believe that's the case, but it can also do the opposite, which is help Iran. And it's clear from other messages that China has been is supporting North Korea, and North Korea is trying to work with Iran to create a nuclear ballistic missile. Or actually, so have this type of missile available for Iran. So then it becomes a pretty clear contest between the US and China, where you have US supports Saudi Arabia and China supports Iran. And the whole issue is about oil. It's not very surprising that people that analyze the situation are predicting perhaps a credit bubble implosion in China, even, because all this economical activity is all dependent on energy, and if the energy is not there or it becomes very expensive, then everything stops. And then of course credit cannot be repaid, because nobody has generates income, because all the money flows away to the oil supply, and there you have your credit collapse. It's not a big surprise. I think you will have a global credit collapse just simply because of peak oil. That's something that people have explained. You cannot really go on like we are going on right now. And people are kept so much in the dark, it's just amazing. Even in our newspaper, of course the worst one we have, the Telegraaf in Holland, it's reported that we have that people don't really care about the climate and don't really care about... They just worry about their pensions and the economy. Yeah, well, that's because their pensions are being screwed up by the bankers. And the same bankers are hiding the fact that the economy is under threat of collapse because of a reduced oil supply. And basically, the economy, the industry, tries to continue its work, its activity, even if it means the population dies. And that's something we have seen basically throughout history, that industrialists don't care about human lives. We saw it in the First World War, Second World War, and of course in the Iraq War. You have to stop the machines that give people the idea that they have that they have something going. You have to redistribute activities. So that's to come back to my agorocentric model. It's very simple. You won't have the energy, or you can't afford the energy in a few years' time to do things long distance, so this whole thing will collapse. These ocean-going container ships use massive amounts of fossil fuels, and it's much more prudent and wise to redirect them, to redirect that fuel. You get much more in return for it, to redirect it to local economies where it can reach. But a lot of places there simply won't be energy, there won't be fossil fuels, which is a good thing. But to deal with that, you have to start looking at your own locality and then simply make a list of what you need to live with the people that are there. And the energy requirements per person are very low, actually, especially if you grow food. You know, I can imagine a human needs about 4 acres or something to provide for its food each year. I'm not sure, actually, I have to look it up, but... And depending on the way you farm, you can do vertical farming in the city, which is very productive. Of course, you shouldn't use any electrical lighting, but just sunlight. But that's a very productive system. And then you can simply, if you, you know, me personally, if I live in a zero emission house, which is well isolated, which you can use straw bales for, which are very cheap. So I'm not cold in the winter. Then, and I have some land to grow my food, and I have some place where I catch my water, then basically I'm done. I'm just done. I'm just completely, well, I don't need anything else. You could say, well, you need something to cook on. Well, you, of course, you can catch sunlight every day, and there's a very promising technology that is hard to explain, but it uses ammonia to store heat. And it's kept rather secret, I think, because it has been used in Australia for a solar thermal energy project, and it's a very efficient way to store energy, because what you do is you heat up ammonia, it splits into hydrogen and nitrogen, and then later you have a catalyst and you burn that combination back into ammonia at a high temperature that has to be set. But it's a very efficient way to store the heat from the sun, because you store it in gas form. And that, of course, you can do that centrally, and then you can redistribute. But all these technologies, this is one of them, are kept under wraps, are kept more or less secret. Just like when I spoke to a guy that worked on concentrated solar power, and I said, well, you know, if you can heat air up just like the air in a jet engine, you know, couldn't you just use a jet engine generator? Which are all these steam power generators are actually jet engines with electrical generators attached, more or less. Wouldn't that be possible? And of course the answer was no, because that is possible. It's done in Australia right now. They're making because then you don't need water. And because you need water, it's hard to make these concentrated solar power plants everywhere. That's the meme, that's the lie, that's the myth. To make oil and gas and fossil fuels seem necessary. They are not necessary. You know, the whole of California can power itself because it just needs a few acres. Well, I've been there. There's enough space. It needs a few, these jet turbines, and you have all the electricity you need. You don't need heat because you know you don't need to. There's just so much lies and myth going on. That it's really making me personally pretty aggressive. It's like I'm going to lose it if I meet some of these people one day. I'm quite sure. But the next thing I will do is, because I of course have to be a little bit disciplined, is to make a video about my bartering system, which is quite relevant at the moment because. If the dollar is collapsing and you want to find out if your local economy has what it needs and you still have internet, of course that's a precondition, but of course you can run it locally and you could also run it standalone. No, not really actually, but it's a system that allows you to create certificates for goods and services that you have to offer, and then you can trade those certificates online without moving the stuff. It has to be representing real stuff, and then once you want to have it, somebody can pick it up. And a very important element is the store where you can store your goods, so it's a central place where you bring it, so you don't have to wait until somebody's home to pick it up, or you don't have to be home for people to pick it up. So when you produce something like milk or butter or whatever, or eggs. Everybody can produce eggs if you can have some chickens. And then you can store it in the store and somebody can pick it up at their convenience. And you get exactly the same system as we have right now with supermarkets. And another thing, a feature of it, is that you can own fractional items. So you can have a bottle of wine and you can trade a half a bottle of wine. Of course, you can only pick it up if you have a full bottle of wine. But that's a very beneficial thing of the store. The store allows you to put things in storage, they're available, and then you can barter with fractional parts of it. People can pay salary in terms of whatever is in the store, and this whole system also connects very well with anybody who produces goods right now. It doesn't have to be homemade stuff. It can also be simply bottles of Coca-Cola or whatever you so it can interact with the real economy as it, or with the economy as it exists right now. But you get a system that has exactly the right amount of money, because it has only the certificates for the goods that actually exist, and the certificates disappear once you take ownership of the goods and the service. I thought of this system in 2007, and I still think it's exactly the right system you need. Exactly, you never have too much money, you never have too little money. You always have exactly the right amount of money to do all the trades that you need. There's another feature of it, which is the metals exchange, which does the same for precious metals. This has a facility for you to incorporate milligrams of gold, silver, platinum, palladium. And those have to be kept in a central place. And I think that's a very important feature for people that want to move into, a solid currency-based economy, and perhaps locally. Because you can have a secret place that that all the users know about to hide the metals in a safe. And of course you have to trust each other. And then you can use the online system to do the trades and to exchange value. And then you can pick it up, whatever you want to have in terms of metal, from the store, from the bank, let's say, and whenever you want. But you can do that outside the knowledge of any authority. So the online system is of course openly visible, but it doesn't have to reference to an actual address where the metals are kept, as long as everybody knows where that is. See, so you can be completely independent. So that's going to be the next thing that I'll do. I really appreciate the views of the video that I made with the Doors music. If you want to help me out, go to Crash JP Morgan, it's crashgpm.com, and vote for my video if they put it up, because I don't think they did it yet. And then I might win 10 ounces of silver. I'm not sure when, but that's the competition they have. If you are interested in this barter shares system, because it's the website, it's called bartershares.com, and want to help me develop it, I need about let's see how much money I need for each month. Well, I would need about 1 ounce of gold to every month to work on this. So that's 60 ounces of silver per month. So if there's 60 people that want this system to have operational, I can work on it for a month to finish it. It's featured. It has feature that says that you can create an economy with a special name, and that's where you log in. And then that's an independent trading economy from all the other ones that are in the system. And then you can link them if you want to. But if you want to link economies that use these metals, the metal bank, then you have to, have to exchange actual. You have to really transport metals from one bank to another. This whole system is based on trust, and it's based on real identities, except for the locations of the banks, and the stores, of course, don't really matter. Whether you know it, where it is not, but I can really understand that people don't want other people to know where they keep their precious metals. It's based on trust and personality, so you will be, if you don't deliver on what you promise to deliver, then you won't be able to operate, and you have to start small. But if you have a group or a community or intentional group or whatever, then this is quite an interesting system. Anyway, that will be the next video. Thanks for listening, and have a good day.